Hi, this is Gerhi, and this is the second video about urban psychology. In the previous video, we discussed some of the negative psychological and physiological impacts of cities on its inhabitants. In this video, I'm going to give you some good and positive news on how the international collective action can lead into very positive results on us and on our cities. It's the famous example of the success of the international collective action in the finding that the ozone layer above the Antarctica appears to be healing, putting the world on track to eventually remedy one of the biggest environmental concerns of the 1980s and 90s. The study, published in Science, states that the phase out of the chlorofluorocarbon chemicals, the CFCs, means that the ozone layer is expected to recover in response. It is recovering slowly, but it is recovering. The Montreal Protocol, a 1987 international treaty ratified by all UN members, successfully spurred nations to eradicate the use of the chlorofluorocarbon chemicals, the CFCs, in products. The agreement followed fears that the ozone depletion could cause serious health and environmental harm through the ultraviolet light that would reach the surface of the Earth through the ozone barrier. The UN estimates that 2 million cases of skin cancer a year have been avoided through the phase out of chlorofluorocarbons. The international collective effort, whether through international organizations, local NGOs, or individual actions, deserve credit and proves that healing the environment, healing the ecosystem, is possible, which will certainly positively reflect on us, on our cities, in many ways, including avoiding diseases, improved health, better productivity, and of course, not compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Nature has lots of positive psychological and physiological impacts on us. So if you are already living in a city or a town which is connected to nature, like mountains, lakes, or greens, please do connect to nature on a regular basis. Go for a walk, go for picnics, do connect to nature. If you're living in a concrete city or a city in the desert or a city which is not connected to nature, please find your nearest place where you have nature, you have mountains, sea, oceans, lakes, or greens, and go there on a weekly or regular basis. According to environmental psychology, spending time in nature rather than human-made environments has three positive effects: reduced stress, improved mood, and improved cognitive performance. There are two mainstream psychology theories that attempt to explain these outcomes. The first one is called psychoevolutionary theory. The psychoevolutionary theory asserts that the positive reaction that humans experience in nature is programmed evolutionarily. Nature was the first place that humans learned to survive by gathering the resources around us, just as our evolutionary ancestors did. Because of the demands of evolution, which mostly include survival and reproduction, humans have positive built-in reactions to natural environments. Psychoevolutionary theory explains how being in nature can reduce stress and improve your mood. Directed attention is the conscious attention you need for cognitive tasks, and this cognitive focus can become fatigued after prolonged mental activity. Most people live out a relatively hectic lifestyle in a human-made environment, filled with social and professional demands. Nature offers a completely different setting, which gently distracts you from the stresses of civilized life. This is when undirected attention, or the subconscious, can take over. This means that nature recharges your mental batteries. Attention restoration theory focuses on explaining how nature improves cognitive performance, but only indirectly explains how nature reduces stress and improves mood. Designing cities and buildings with nature goes well beyond the positive effect of nature on the human brain and mood. Modern urban planning and architecture studies have many views, ideas, standards, and regulations towards ecologically responsive design. It should be acknowledged that many of the Earth's ecosystems are very complex to be quantified and holistically considered in a design. It is an ongoing process of development and learning how to design with nature. Urban morphology is a significant science studying the topic. Urban morphology is the study of the form of human settlements and the process of their formation and transformation. The study seeks to understand the spatial structure and character of metropolitan area, city, town, or village by examining the patterns of its component parts and the ownership or control and occupation. Typically, analysis of physical form focuses on street pattern and building pattern, sometimes referred to collectively as urban grain. Special attention is given to how the physical form of a city changes over time and how different cities compare to each other. Another significant part of this subfield deals with the study of the social forms which are expressed in the physical layout of a city and conversely how physical form produces or reproduces various social forms. Ecopsychology is a quite interesting field examining many of what we have been discussing, particularly the aspects of nature that recall what evolutionary psychologists have termed the environment of evolutionary adaptiveness, the natural conditions that the human species evolved to inhabit. The field of ecopsychology extends beyond the conventional purview of psychology, which had traditionally considered the psyche to be a matter of relevance to humans alone. Ecopsychology examines why people continue environmentally damaging behaviors and to develop methods of positive motivation for adopting sustainable practices. Evidence suggests that many environmentally damaging behaviors are addictive at some level and thus are more effectively addressed through positive emotional fulfillment rather than by inflicting shame. The brains of people living in cities operate differently from those in rural areas. According to a brain scanning study, scientists found that two regions involved in the regulation of emotion and anxiety become overactive in city dwellers when they are stressed and argue that the differences could account for the increased rates of mental health problems seen in urban areas. So that's it for me for today. Thank you so much for listening. Until next time, see you soon.